someone will have an issue with it, but...
Hello, Parkland staff, and welcome back. It's such an honor to be here today as your opening speaker. My name is Vasily Montenegros, and I'm going into ninth grade. I've been in Parkland my whole life. Probably I started in Parkland Manor, then Springhouse Middle School, and now here at the high school. I was asked to be here today to tell you guys about how excited I am to be going back to school again. But first I want to take a second to reflect on the past year. You know, it was different and it was definitely hard for a lot of us. I miss my friends and I really just miss school in general. But what I wanted to say is that we are all thankful for you guys, the staff. You know, for all of you who had to teach fully online, for everyone who reached out to the students, even though you were probably exhausted too, and for just caring about us in general. You know, you guys are so great, and we all appreciate you so much. And we just do what you do best, and we will take it from there. That's all from me. I'll hand you guys over. Have a great school year.
Thank you.
I mentioned to that, so he outdid you that we would have some discussions afterwards. I guess my time afterwards already taken. Good morning, everyone. Welcome back to opening day of the 21-22 school year. I'm Rod Chalker, Assistant Superintendent of Schools. For the past 11 years, I've had the honor of greeting each of you at our opening day convocation. You know, the administrative team is always excited to have everybody gathered around. Unfortunately, today, you know, we all can't be together, but I know out on our TV network, our teachers are back in their rooms and hopefully enjoying our annual opening day convocation. You know, many individuals that are assembled here have worked tirelessly, you know, to prepare the buildings, to prepare the staff. We had a lot of hires again this year. It's just a continual process that the summer, you know, for many people who think that the summer ends for administrators, it just keeps going. You know, our administrators, our secretarial staff, our custodial staff, you know, they just do a super job of preparing our buildings and you know, being ready for, you know, individuals like you just saw, as well as all of the people that are here with us today on TV. We couldn't be more proud of the work that they do to keep Parkland, you know, in a different way, up to and above par than the expectations our community has. And I specifically want to thank Dave Keppel and his staff at the School Services Department, not only for the cleanliness of our building, but also, you know, the dedication last year and the ability to initiate the health safety plan and the requirements of that plan, but also the construction projects, some really, really positive construction projects coming to an end, you know, a new driveway at Parkway Manor, a new driveway at Schnitzel Elementary School. You know, not only good for, you know, the staff and the students and the drivers and the bus drivers, but also good for the community. And we're a community school, and I think we help our community by doing the right things in our schools. And so we're proud of the work that's being done there. You know, I'd be remiss if I didn't thank Sherry D for her hard work, as well as Dr. Madsen on our health safety plan. Dr. Madsen came and walked into, you know, not the most ideal situation for the superintendent. We'll talk a little bit about that later. But our health safety plan is up and running, and tonight we'll have a meeting and we'll finalize our health safety plan for the start of school. Proud of the work that everyone's done towards that and making sure that our students and our staff return to the building safely. You know, the pandemic has created many challenges, and those of you who were with us last year know about those challenges, and you did an absolutely wonderful job. You met some of the most difficult tasks that are thrown in front of you, and you met them with dignity, and you met them with dedication that only Parkland teachers know how. Whether it be online, whether it be in a hybrid format, you did the extra. You went the extra mile. You didn't do it for you, you did it for our kids. I'd say thank you for that. You know, as we begin opening day, I really, really hope you had an enjoyable summer. It was certainly one of the summers where you really, really needed it. You know, hopefully you reconnected with family, as the pandemic didn't allow that to happen for many of us. We really hope that you had that opportunity and you did spend some quality time with family. I think one thing we learned over the pandemic is the importance of family. As we move more into our school year, I want to talk about really quickly the personal touch. You showed that last year in the way you operated and you adjusted very, very rapidly. But now more than ever, that personal touch may be the most important thing, maybe even more important than academics as we start the school year. Don't let academics get in the way of making that personal connection. Students went through some challenging times last year, as did you. You know your challenges were exactly, if not, you know, a little less than what students had to go through, trying to learn various modalities in and out of classrooms. You know, that they struggled, and we want to be there for them this year. We need to build that relationship portion of what you do so well. As we continue to move on, I really hope that as building in grade level content areas, you share your talents with each other. I think maybe that may have been another key lesson from the pandemic. We couldn't have been more happy at the work that was done by our teachers themselves, not only in the teaching realm, but also teaching each other. I think we learned the importance of collaboration and working together. You know, as our classes became more successful, the more we collaborated. Please know that all students will benefit from these talents that you have. And the more you share those talents with one another, the more students will reach their very highest potential. And again, we know that this year is going to be like last year, like none other than we've seen in education. But remind us that this past year also brought about many positive qualities in our staff and in our students. I know the quality staff that we have here, and I know the challenges that you faced last year and that I know you'll face the adversity that you have this year. I know that you'll meet the challenges of pandemic and whatever that brings to us, because I know you're in it for our kids. We thank you gratefully for all you did for our students. You know, each year we're fortunate to have with us on opening day some very, very extremely dedicated educational leaders who play a very major role in the operational success of the Parkland School District. You know, at this time I'd like to introduce a few of them. First, I have the privilege of introducing our new superintendent of schools. Our new superintendent has been thrust into a pandemic which has challenged leaders across the Lehigh Valley and the country. And while handling the health and safety of students, he's also making an effort to get out and about and meet and greet every individual that he can see. He has proven already to me to be a tireless worker, and I'm proud to introduce our new superintendent of schools, Dr. Mark Madsen. During this pandemic, our Board of School Directors have held these standards very, very high and take great care in managing the health and safety of our staff and our students. The pandemic has been exceptionally challenging for our school board members as they field countless emails. But they are doing what they do best, focus on the health safety of our students, our staff, and our children. Can't say more about the dedication that our school board members have to the success of our organization as a whole. And I appreciate that greatly. You know, board members are very rarely recognized for the work they do on behalf of the students and the staff and the community. But we should be all thankful for the work that they do. I am thankful to work under their leadership, and I'm pleased to introduce those that are with us today. First, our school board president, Mr. David Hine. School psychologist. adding quality professionals to our family. We welcome the teachers who have recently finished the orientation, and we hope to see them in the very near future in their classrooms. Please welcome them as you meet them and greet them in your individual schools. The administration is looking forward to that. Also with us are many members of our support team who equally play an active role in the success of our school district. We thank you for all you do. Your work is an integral part of the formula of success in the district. Welcome back, and we look forward to seeing you again into our buildings. As we move into our agenda a little bit further, our first guest is a dedicated, hardworking school board member who focuses his attention on leadership of students, on behalf of the students, staff, and engaged community in the benefits of the district. He currently serves as president-elect of the Pennsylvania School Boards Association. He has worked hard to unify the community throughout this pandemic. He's proud to represent the Parkland Board of School Directors, and I would like to introduce Mr. David.
Because as Dr. Troutman said, there's been a lot that's been happening around the community, in our meetings, around the country. But the focus has to be back on the kids. And the reason I paused there for a second is because we're all gonna see a week from now, less than a week, all of our children back in our buildings 5 days a week. Whatever that might look like, however that plays out, the biggest thing is we're going to have our kids back in the classroom 5 days a week. And you're going to get to see those smiling faces every single day. Mask, no mask, whatever the case may be. Right? We know where we're at right now. So I'm excited for a second reason, because we got Tom Murray here today, and he's going to help kick us off with a great message this morning. I've seen him many times, and we just can't wait to have him start. So a couple thank yous, all right? The first thing I'd like to say is there's a lot of people on this list, as you can see. School board, thank you very much for all the tireless effort and work that you've done, not only now, but throughout the past year. It's been a lot of work for everybody. I want to thank the entire admin team. I know you're sitting in the back there, and Dr. Troutman, Dr. Minotti, for all the work that you guys have done to get us to this place where we are right now. Something we're very, very excited about. I know that Liz and Sandy are here. I want to thank you for all of your leadership and work with your groups. We've got a chance to get to know each other over the past month. Very appreciative of that. We have a few students that are here today to help us out. We had one welcome us this morning. We have a couple more that will be coming out in a little bit. I want to thank them. How about the cheerleaders? How about another? I know that they're gone, but how about another round of applause for the cheerleaders? We had the marching band out there. For those of you that were here in person, appreciate that so much. Kick things off for us. Nicole Magala, I know she's here somewhere. She was instrumental for me. She was my chauffeur for a lot of the tours that we did. Took me around the Parkland School District quite a bit. So I appreciate her effort. I know Kelly Kester and Chris, they're both here too, Chenworth, for all the work that they've done. Our tech department, just amazing setup to pull this off. We kind of talked about it mid last week, and we said, hey, what can we do? We're in a little different situation than we were even 3 weeks ago. As we know, everything is changing. Maybe the auditorium is not the right spot. We want to give people options who may be not comfortable to come in this large group right now. What can we do? And Tom and your department just did a fantastic job to bring everything together, and I appreciate that. Thank you very much. Dr. Chapman already mentioned the buildings and grounds crew and for all the work that they've done. We also want to thank our sponsors that are here today. They do a tremendous job of working with our staff and working with the community. So we want to make sure that we thank them very much for all of the efforts, and they're out there. Make sure that you see them, for those of you that are here in person, because we really appreciate that, especially Costco helping us out with the food and some coffee this morning. I also want to thank two more groups real quick, really one individual and another group. And he's not here today, but a lot of things got cut short last year with the pandemic. Too many things. And this might be a minor one, but to me, it's a pretty big one. Rich Snizak spent many, many years, I don't know how many, but a tremendous amount of time in this school district. And unfortunately, with the pandemic, really a lot of things were changed around. And I, as a new superintendent coming in, some of the things that I'll talk about, it's really important that we honor some of those things, and we honor history, and we honor culture. And he's been a great mentor, even in a short amount of time, for me. He was a great leader for this school district, and I wanted to take a second to thank him and appreciate all of his work that he's done for this school district. Next group is our Parkland Pride Award winners. Again, something that was kind of cut short, done a little bit differently. I know, I believe in the past, a lot of times that those award winners would be represented and introduced today at the opening welcome back ceremony. And that was done this spring. So I wanted to take a second just to thank them, congratulate those individuals who received these awards. It's something that's really important to the community and to the staff. It's something we want to continue and make sure that we have continuation of that over the next school year. But again, because of things being cut short, I just wanted to say thank you. When we started last week, we had our new teachers. Dr. Troutman talked about new teachers coming in. And in early July, we had an admin team. And I just wanted to make sure that the entire staff knew the two messages that I, as the new superintendent, gave to the group. And so for our new teachers, we talked about four different things, really briefly. And one of those is passion. And it takes no skill, it takes no experience. It takes nothing to be passionate about what you're doing. Make sure that you're passionate in everything that you do every single day. And we talked about also being yourself. Don't try to be someone else that you can't be. In today's world, with everything happening, be smart and get involved. No matter what it is that you do, whether you're a new teacher, someone who's been around the block for a while, get involved. The kids, more than ever, need you to be involved in what we're doing. And then we had a couple things that we talked about as an admin team. I talked about family, we talked about team building, we talked about belonging, and we talked about the status quo. And when we did that, we went through some things, and I talked about different pieces that may be important to me as an individual, as a superintendent, as an educator. We talked about family, how important family is to all of us. It's not secondary, it's gotta be number one. There's no negotiation on family. And that family extends not just to your immediate family that you have in your home, but think about all the time that we spend together every single day for the benefit of kids. That's your extended family. Treat them as such, right? We talked about belonging. We talked about the status quo. As I mentioned about Rich, keeping things that historically are important to the school district, we want to make sure that we're doing that, but at the same time, you know, we don't accept the status quo for what it is. We look for opportunities to continue and grow, and we try to find where those areas are. So many of you may have had a time in your life where you sit back and you can say, my life profoundly changed in one instance. And so this is a quote from someone that was a mentor of mine. When I first started teaching, graduated college, got my first teaching job up in Newton, Massachusetts, right outside of Boston. And I was helping the coach football, and I was teaching, and a couple weeks in, Peter Capitalupo, who was the head football coach, also an English teacher there, and I gave a couple stories to the new teachers and to the admin team, and I won't bore everybody with all of these. But one of the things that he said at one point to me was this right here. Now, I paraphrased it a little bit, changed it, but he said, Mark, remember, you're coaching someone's son, or you're teaching someone's daughter. And in an instant, things profoundly changed for me in how I operated, how I connected, how I worked with people. And I've carried that through all the way to this point. And it extends beyond just kids. The custodians, the bus drivers, our teachers, staff, cafeteria workers, our principals. Those people are everything to someone else. Their mothers, their fathers, their uncles, their grandfathers, their children. And that's important. And that's so critical. And why is that critical? It's critical for many different reasons, because we bring kids into our buildings every single day. And we want to make sure that they feel like this is a family. And this is a tremendous atmosphere for them to be in. And that people really matter. And if you read my opening letter, welcome back letter, I started with this. Because in my belief, nothing can happen in the classroom without the relationships that you build with kids. And you are that important. The minute they step on the bus, the minute they go to lunch, when they're in your classroom, you matter. The relationships you build with people matter. And I want to break that down just a second further. Coming from another school district where, hey, it's the middle of a pandemic. Who in the world wants to take a job as a superintendent in the middle of a pandemic, right? So I had a couple of different interviews here. And in one of the interviews, I was perplexed a little bit and challenged because the board had asked for me to come in. And they weren't going to ask any questions during that round. There were no questions that were going to be asked. And they would give me 45 minutes to talk about myself. And I thought, wow, that's, first of all, what am I going to say for 45 minutes? No questions. They gave me some prompts. Obviously, in the other rounds, there were many questions about skills and qualifications. and experience. And I was preparing for that, thinking about what I would say. It dawned on me how that connected to what I believe. And I knew at that point, this was the place for me. The fact that the school board wanted to know about me, the person, I knew the type of environment that I was going to walk into. And it played out to be true. Now, it's only been a couple months. I'm still here after all this. But I can tell you that that philosophy resonates everywhere in this district, everywhere. So, I'll give you a quick funny story. One of my first tours that we did, again, my chauffeur, Nicole, we went down to Citronia. And inevitably, we went to a couple different classrooms. And I know Jamie's here somewhere, so don't worry, Jamie. It's not going to be any story that I learned about you guys during our breakfast with the elementary principals, by the way. Very interesting group of individuals. And Karen, I feel bad for both of you, by the way. Just want to point that out. But inevitably, you go into classrooms and kids, they have no idea. Many people don't know. What does the superintendent even do? So they would ask, that's the question. That was the number one question. Got introduced, you're the new superintendent. We've talked about that. So inevitably, that was the question. So Jamie, I don't know if you remember this, but in one of the rooms we went to, maybe Nicole does, young man sitting in the back, raised his hand. Dr. G called on him. He stood up. Do you know what the superintendent does? And he said, yes, I do. And Dr. G said, well, okay, why don't you share with us? The superintendent can fire you as the principal anytime that he wants to. And we all chuckled, we laughed, and Jamie got red, and you know, because it was the first time that I had met him as well. The first building I was in, first impression. We walk out of that classroom, and what struck me was that Jamie knew every single thing about that young man. Everything. History, family situation, things that were going well, things that weren't going well. He knew everything. And then as we walked the halls, he did the same over and over again, all of these kids. And then what I noticed was the teachers as well. Anytime a student would say something to me or ask a question, the teacher right away could tell me everything about that child. It was amazing. It was an amazing experience. Once again, thinking back to what I say about people and the connections, it resonated right away. First tour, first day, first stop, Citronia Elementary School. And then what I found was that was carried out over and over and over and over again. Again, more confirmation that I made the right decision. So this is Lisa. Some of you may know Lisa. And I bring this up because even though I'm new to Parkland, the Lehigh Valley is a really small place, right? There's a lot of connections. There's a couple people in this audience here and probably that are watching live that I actually went to high school with. So they could probably tell you some stories, and those would be for another day. But one person who I'd never met before, we had never met until this day, and indirectly, she's part of the reason why I'm actually here at all. So her sister was a teacher at my high school, Andrea Newman. She was a business teacher. She's the reason why I became a teacher. Because of the way that she treated us as kids, the passion that she had for her job, the connections that she made with us. And I bring that up because every day, you never know. I use a saying sometimes that we talk about interviews. Every day is an interview. But in a microcosm of that, there are a million interactions that happen every day. And you never know what interaction is going to lead to one thing or another. And I can't tell you how proud I am of every single one of you. I haven't got to know everybody yet, just in what I've seen, the information that I've tried to digest in a short amount of time. Everybody here has made a decision and a call to service, and a service of kids. And that doesn't come lightly, especially in today's world. And you should be thankful for that. You should be grateful for that. But you should also be thanked for that because of the work that you do. And always remember, you don't know what interaction is going to lead to something down the road. Because I know, actually I can see a couple former classmates of mine, they probably would have never thought in a million years that I would be standing in this spot right here. But the only reason that that happens is because of the interactions, the mentorship, the work that happens over and over and over again. To build on that, this whole cyber world, and this is Nicole, another person that I met in my travels. I couldn't imagine, I don't think anyone could imagine, having to have had taught online with only a couple weeks of training, everybody come in together. You know, 100 years from now, people are going to look back on you, not on me, not on us, on the teaching staff and the staffs in schools, and say, how in the world did you make this happen? How in the world could you have done this in such a short amount of time? It is unbelievable. And the joy and passion that she had in her classroom, even though she had a mask on, she had to put it on, she had to take it off, I got to meet her, I got to say hello to the children. It was amazing. Teaching is not a job you chose, right? It's a calling. It's a lifestyle. And I hope that you recognize that not only do we appreciate it as administrators, the school board appreciates it, the entire community appreciates it. Even when sometimes it seems like they don't, they do. They do. So you might ask about this one. I hope everyone can see that. It took me a long time to figure out, how am I going to play this one? But again, on some tours, this picture was too good to pass up. And I think it's like a perfect proportion of head to body with Mr. Gombos. I could just see him on Tatooine right now with a lightsaber. We've had some stories. Todd, I hope you don't mind, I'm taking some water right now, if that's okay. It's an inside joke and anyone can ask later about what that means. But this is just the culmination of, again, where walking around these buildings, there was such joy, even though we were in a hybrid mode, kids were only there a couple days a week, the way that the principals were interacting with their staff, staff to staff, staff with their kids. This was K-12. This wasn't just something I saw in the elementary levels. This was everywhere. And the relationships that people have built over time. And my job, hopefully, is to remove any barriers that you have moving forward to make sure that the kids are put in the best possible situation to be successful, whatever that might mean. That's our job as administrators. Sometimes we guide, sometimes we lead, but more than anything, we listen. We listen to what you need. We try to build those relationships so that you, as individuals within your buildings, feel comfortable and feel part of the family, so that kids will feel part of that family. And we are Parkland strong. And I think Mr. Hine mentioned, you know, what is it going to look like? I talked to the admin team in the summer about the challenges that we face as we move forward. And unfortunately, it's going to be difficult. We talked about that early in the summer, that in some ways it might even be more difficult. And I don't say that in a way to bring bad news. I say it as a way to be opportunistic and optimistic about what we're doing as we move forward. If I'm a fifth grade teacher, I might have students who were in a two-day week hybrid online in Parkland. They might have been in a cyber school. They might have been homeschooled. They may have been in another state. Now they're all coming back into my classroom. Building that sense of community and culture within that classroom becomes imperative and so important. But I have no doubt, it didn't take me long to figure out, I have no doubt that this community, this staff, this district is up for the challenge. And I cannot wait to get started. So I'm like the precursor, you know, I'm like the warm-up band before like the real professional goes, and he's gonna start in a second, which is probably why I usually don't get a little bit nervous, but I was a little bit nervous because I'm under pressure with him here, but a good pressure. Our job too as administrators, one last point, is for all of us to rise above all of the nonsense. We want you to focus on our kids and teaching. We'll worry about all of the other things that have to go. We talked about health and safety plans and masks and face coverings. Let us worry about that. You focus on the kids. You focus on what's important. So before I go and turn it over to Dr. Minotti, we do have a little bit of a special treat for you today. I think we have a couple young ladies who are here with us to share a message. I'm not sure. I'm looking behind me because I don't know which side of the aisle they might be on. But I think Ashlyn and Reese, are you girls back here? There we are. All right. Welcome.
This past year was challenging.
Yeah, lots of yuck.
But we are so excited to be coming back to school again, 5 days a week. Renew, reconnect, thrive.
That's what the Parkland Education Foundation wishes for all of you and what they wish for all of us students.
What a nice message for opening day when all of us students come back to school.
If you want one, all you have to do is turn in your pledge card on the way out.
The first 330 employees to do so will get one of these today.
No gift is too small. Even $1 per paycheck makes a difference. We wish you a great start to the school year.
Great job, girls. Thank you so much. Thank you. Slogan as part of the foundation campaign this year. We worked a lot to talk about different things and bringing us back as a school community. It really embodies what we hope to do this year. And what I've learned is how big of a part that Education Foundation plays in this community. And when I heard this number, I was shocked. But as I got to learn a little bit more about the community, it didn't surprise me as much that our own employees in Parkland gave over $28,000 last year to support the foundation. $28,000 from just our employees to support this foundation. That is unbelievable. It's a truly amazing number. And the more that I've got to learn how it supports the mission of the district and the staff and support the students, it's just amazing. Funding grants to assist our hybrid e-learning teachers in their transition. Athletic event live streaming. To make science come to life with virtual science labs for our high school teachers. Brought whiteboards for all of the third grade teachers at Kernsville. And again, enabled them to show their work to the teachers when they were online. Just a few examples. For the year ahead, they funded 51 Celebrate Innovation grants that in excess of $100,000, $113,000 for this year, this upcoming school year. The amount of support that they provide is really, truly amazing. So please, think about continuing that effort in this time more than ever, in every community, not just in Parkland, these foundations can help support so many different outstanding programs. You get a free cool t-shirt out of the deal as well, which is nice. And if you did get a pledge card, make sure that you do. I'll be filling mine out today as well. And I think it just speaks volumes to the community, speaks volumes to people connecting, and it speaks most volumes to you as a staff. I truly hope that you have a great school year. I'm humbled and honored to be here, and will continue to work with you to make the lives of our kids better. Thank you very much. I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Minotti.
I've been here for 21 years, and I've worked with many of you in different leadership capacities, and it has been an honor leading and learning with you to do what is best for kids. For those of you I do not know yet, I look forward to meeting you and look forward to, for all of us, to be serving our students in this amazing Parkland community together. Our district theme symbolizes our unity in educating the whole child. This foundation is built on caring, commitment, and growth. So thank you for pouring in your heart and your talents to each student as you build that bridge between home and school. Now what you've all been waiting for. I feel like I should have had the drum roll here with the band, so we missed that. Our team is really excited today to introduce our keynote speaker, Mr. Tom Murray. Tom is here today. Many of you know Tom. He's a Parkland parent. His family is here today, so welcome, Tammy. We have Paisley, who is going to sixth grade at Springhouse. And we have Caden, who is going into second grade at Veterans Memorial. So welcome. Tom is a friend of district, and he's a very dear friend of mine. And anytime, as administrators, we needed anything over the years, especially last year, Tom was always there to help and support us. And so when our administrative team got together, we thought, who better than Tom to start this year off with a really positive mindset? To give you a little background on Tom, Tom serves as a director of innovation for Future Ready Schools, a project of the Alliance for Excellent Education, which is located in DC. He has testified before the United States Congress and has worked alongside that body in the US Senate, the White House, and the US Department of Education and State Departments of Education and school districts throughout the country to implement student-centered learning. He is the best-selling author of the books Learning Transformed and Personal and Authentic. And to keep it personal and authentic, I would like to ask his children, Paisley and Caden, to come up and finish this intro with me. Is that okay? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. My dad serves as a regular conference keynote. He was named one of the 20 to watch by NSBA in 2018. He was the Educational Thought Leader of the Year in 2017 and the Educational Policy Person of the Year by the Academy of Arts and Sciences in 2015. Most importantly, he is out of here. Thank you, Dr. for helping our teachers today and how kids are doing here.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Paisley and Caden. Without further ado, Mr. Tom Murray.
All right, everybody, stand up, Parkland, stand up. Oh yeah, he's one of those speakers, you better believe him. It's go time, my friends. Here's what I need you to do. I need you to pair up with somebody in any socially distant way that you're comfortable. I want you to pair up with somebody and get back to back with that person. Oh, really? Yeah.
To that.
My partner is hiding two, which you cannot see. I'm going to call one, two, three. When I say three, you turn, you face me. each other. Whoever screams out the number, when you add the two together, gets a point. So here we go. When I say, if I've got three and my partner's got two, whoever yells out up, five. You've got three people that need that answer. That's not a good part. Gets a point. Here we go.
Environment where our kids want to be.
want to be, especially in the midst of such chaos and fear in our world. So let me ask you, what is it that you intentionally do to build the culture you're working? What do you intentionally do? Now, I didn't ask what your principal does. I didn't ask what your superintendent does or your great board does. I asked you. It's real easy in our world to point the finger, isn't it? If our department chair would finally just, if my teaching partner would actually, if our principal would finally, if our new superintendent would actually, if our board would finally, if Governor Wolf would actually, like, that's actually really easy, isn't it? You know what's hard in our world for me? Asking the same question of a person that I shave with in one. And by the way, I'm not talking about my wife. I'm talking about myself. Standing in the hallway quicker. you happen to have your own child, or a child somewhere in your family, or a child that you remotely care about somewhere on earth, do I have y'all now?
If I have you, you're wrong.
And then that child was walking through that hall. Which teacher do you want to walk by? Which teacher are you? Which principal are you? Which superintendent are you? You see, every interaction really doesn't matter, right? Because every time we bring people together, it's an opportunity to build culture. Admin team, every faculty meeting, it's an opportunity to build culture. Teachers, every time we kick off a given day, it's an opportunity to build culture in our school. Because right now, our school's culture, I totally believe, perfectly aligns with the mindset and the actions of us in this room and watching worship. And it doesn't matter if that custodian, or that secretary, or that teacher, or that superintendent, or that principal, my good friend Todd Whitaker talks about admin, how we set the tone, and I totally agree with that. But if we're in the sound of our voice, we absolutely impact culture every given day. Really put it this way, my friends. If on Monday, when our kids come to you, and if on Monday, every student that walked into your classroom had your attitude and gave your effort and had your mindset today, what kind of learning environment would it be? Let me say that again. If every student that walked into your classroom on Monday had your mindset, gave your effort, had your attitude today, what kind of learning environment would it be? Now, I can answer that because I know the passion, the energy, the amazing people that I stand in front of today. And I can answer that by saying it would be an incredible, incredible place. But it's really easy to say we expect certain things from kids and then turn around and model something different ourselves, isn't it? When you walk into that faculty room, do you build the energy up? Or do you suck the energy out?
Data on the screen.
Can I tell you what that moment with her daddy was like? Taking her out of her high chair, running to the car, and driving literally 100 miles an hour to the closest hospital. Can I tell you what that moment was like as I begged God to save our baby girl? Can I tell you what it was like putting the park, running into the hospital, screaming for an EpiPen? Can I tell you about that moment? Can I tell you what it was like watching the nurse come out, stab her in the leg with an EpiPen, watch her start to be able to breathe again? You've never seen somebody come out of anaphylaxis. It is truly a miracle. Can I tell you what it was like laying next to her crib that night, listening for every single breath, just to make sure that little girl was breathing? You see, it's the power of the story. It's the power of a personal connection. You see, I call it the hidden stories within. And a kingdom building culture is having empathy for the hidden stories inside of other people. You see, what if I told you the rest of that story? What if I told you that was data from her second grade year into her third grade year, and that little girl now eats over 2,000 seeds of sesame. She's been hospitalized multiple times for just a few. Over 2,000 seeds of sesame every single day through power to keep her safe in her daily dose. What if I told you in those 35 absences, every single one of them, she was 2 hours from here in Suffern, New York, going through food allergy therapy as the first child in the Northeast to do it for sesame? What if I told you that? What if I told you 19 of the 20 tardies, one of them, we were just late. Sorry, we signed the paper, okay? In 19 of the 20 tardies, we were 2 hours from home. She'd come back in the afternoon, we would drop her off at school. Thank you, Mrs. Thomas. Thank you, Mr. Boyer. For when that little girl walked back into your classroom, it wasn't here's the five things you missed again this Monday. Because of your love that was paid, and we're so glad you're here. Recently doing it again for Trina. Thank you, Mrs. Richenacker. Thank you, Mrs. Kleck. For loving her, for her, not seeing just absences. You see, data is important, and we use data all the time. But data without understanding the story, we can make some really bad decisions for kids. You see, you look at the data, it's one piece, it's one part of the picture. But when I tell you the story behind the data, it totally changes the context of what you think, doesn't it? How do we get to know the stories of our students this year? You see, when I talk about the hidden stories within, I'm actually not just talking about our kids, I'm talking about you. See, every one of us here has stories on our heart, and maybe they're really great things. Maybe this weekend is your anniversary, you're getting away with your spouse for the first time in 2 years, totally kid-free, and you're super excited. And here's the thing, nobody else here knows. Nobody else here knows. Here's the flip side. Maybe you're struggling today. Maybe here we are talking about loving kids and celebrating kids and all this stuff, and last night was one of those nights at your own house with your own teenage daughter. And getting today, here today, was a struggle. You see, it's the hidden stories within, and the stories matter every single time. Take a moment, if you would, to watch this. Thank you. You won't always know. But do we create an environment of trust, the culture of trust, the relationships where people feel, if they want to, comfortable to share with you? And certainly we have to honor times where things are so personal and people don't want to share. Of course, we honor that. Do we create an environment where we give opportunities? Shout out to Mrs. Plackner last year in fifth grade for on that first night of school. One of those assignments she asked us as parents, a parent inventory, a parent questionnaire, was asking, what is it that makes your child bold and courageous or something to that effect? You know what I told them about? What we just shared. So on day two, she had an opportunity to have an inkling. And it was my daughter, my little girl, sitting right there into her heart. You know why? Because she asked. Because she gave an opportunity for parents to share. She created an environment for kids to share. You see the difference between making a judgment, which we all do naturally, my friends. Your brain is wired to make connections and sense of the world around it. But the difference between making a judgment and having empathy, it's understanding the story. And my friends, a story, the child's story, really defines the context in which his or her learning occurs. Let me give you some examples. Stories of racism. Stories of neglect, stories of hope, stories of opportunity, stories of plenty, stories of love because of an amazing second grade teacher like you. The stories matter every single time. How do we get to know the stories of our students this coming year? But as Mark shared just a little while ago on the screen, you saw some of the exact same words. What gets in the way? Sometimes it's, well, that's just the way we've always done it. What's been interesting in the last year and a half is COVID really didn't care how we did it in the past. It forced us to do a lot of things differently. COVID didn't care how we had graduation in 2019. It forced us to do things differently. COVID didn't care in March of 2020 how we had taught. It forced us to do things differently. And that's just the way we've always done it. Mindset can be some of the most dangerous words in education or in any business. Talk to any professional out there. If that was their mindset, I would prove it to you. I mean, how many of you are working out? Don't put your hand up. Working out like, I don't know, working out like you're doing.
Back to your classroom on Tuesday.
what I need you to do, take out your yellow folder, let's take out the yellow index card, take out your reading book. Oh yeah, that was, I think that's like $212. You don't want to mess this one up. We need to get that filled. We're going to fill this form out. Here's an extra form for you, by the way. All right, so 20 minutes later, it looked like this. All right, boys and girls, so the next three rows is going to have science. Everything in science is going to be green. So what I need you to do is take out your science folder, take out everything to be green. Once you write science on your folder, no, honey, that says since. Science, copy it from up there, okay, good. Oh, the science textbook, yeah, you gotta get this one covered tonight. So, you get the point. At the end of the day, from Tom Murray's classroom, I have no idea how y'all do, but hear me out. For the very first day of Tom Murray's classroom, I'm pretty sure my kids went home with something like this. With every single textbook, every single folder, and 47 forms to get picked up tonight, and signed up tonight, there we go. We're probably looking back, like, I can't wait to freaking go do that again tomorrow.
New teachers in the room, new teachers. The only reason I did that is they're living hope for our stability for our community. When you've been the calm on the other end of Zoom or Google Meet, when you've been that beacon of hope for our families, you've redefined fear, and you continue to do it by reopening this year and doing it the safe ways and doing everything you can to keep our kids safe and you safe. You've redefined fear. Because you've looked at it as you said, we're going to face everything and rise. And I stand in awe because I know you. I watch you. I've seen so many of your classrooms and the connections. And I know that what you do is you face everything and you rise every single day. Because here's the thing, you don't have to be here. And I'm not talking about in this gym right now. I'm talking about you choose every single day to be an Parkland employee, because every one of us has the opportunity to walk away tomorrow if we want to. Every one of us. But you don't. You choose to stay in the midst of fear and anxiety and adversity. You put your hand up and say, I will be that beacon of hope for our community. I will help our kids. I will be stability for our families. And it's why I stand in awe as one of your dads in the work that you do each and every single day. You see, I really believe these moments of uncertainty, and they're pretty plentiful, aren't they? They really do create opportunities for good leadership legacy. And if you just heard me say leadership, you're like, wait, no, I'm not a principal. Well, that's the mindset. Don't tell me you don't need kids. And every single day, and here's the thing, I don't think your legacy is built in the moments where we know what to do, where things are cruising by, we're flying high, and things are good, and we all need those moments. I actually think our legacy is in education and the work in your classrooms are often built in the moments where you don't know what to do. And how often, how frequently does that happen in our world? Take a look at that picture. It was a year and a half later, on a roller coaster, hands up high. Show that California once, and a lady in the back yells out, that's because he's with your wife!
I wasn't arguing that one.
Here's my point, my friends. You know, I show that two things. Number one, he had his people around him. Education can be the loneliest profession in the world, especially the higher up you go. If my mindset is a teacher, I'm just going to close my door and do my own thing. It is going to be a lonely, lonely place. But getting to work with thousands and thousands of educators every single year throughout this whole pandemic, you know what I can tell you? Collaboration is at an all-time high. The moment in the mindset of not I got you, but I've got you, is at an all-time high. Don't lose that, because if you're in this work together, his people were around him. Second piece, he had some experience, just like you do. Yeah, the fear and the anxiety are very real right now. Let's call it what it is. But unless you're brand new day one into teaching, this isn't your first rodeo in teaching in the middle of a global pandemic. We've been there, we've done it, it hasn't been perfect. We've had to work through things, but the experience absolutely matters. My friends, if our habits and our work have more resilience than our purpose, the impacts that we want to have will be shattered, won't it? You see, if I'm going to talk about being personal and authentic in the midst of adversity, we also have to learn to fail forward. You know what I know about every one of you? I know how much you care. I know that you want things to go really, really well. You want your students to have an amazing experience. You want those moments you're getting observed to go really well so your principal can see the greatness happening in your schools. But here's the reality. Things happen. How we fail forward in this work. Let me make it the analogy this way. Like, here you are. It's a nice day. You're cruising. You got the break that you totally deserved. But my friends, look. I mean, you know it's coming. You know it's coming. How do you fail forward? I want to show you one of my very favorite videos that's out there on failing forward. Hear me out for a moment. Because in those moments in your classroom when things happen, when the unexpected happens, in the moment when you're teaching virtually and tools aren't working, something disconnects, in those moments, how do you respond? I want to see a great example of failing forward. Take a moment if you would to watch this.
We'll bring you on into the temps that we're all doing okay. Wow, 750 degrees in Kilo Bin right now. And 1,270 in Albuquerque. Now, I'm not authorized to evacuate Albuquerque. These temperatures are pretty hot.
Cape Creek.
Yeah, Cape Creek, Fountain Hills, they don't look good either. And frankly, Wickenburg is a total loss. You might as well just get out of anywhere along the 60 years. A very warm surprise is starting to heat up as well at 1,300 degrees. So. The same spot seems to be Chandler and Mesa. Scottsdale is doing okay so far, but you know, you're sort of surrounded by some pretty intense heat. So, you know, again, I'm not your dad, but I will get out. Steel boys at about this temperature, so
I mean, you know exactly. Tell me that's not your world. You know how this goes. Like, earring turkey look. And they walk to the back of the classroom. And they sit down in the back of the classroom, and here they are. And they sit down with the pen, and they go, and they're looking, and they wait, and they're waiting for you. And you're like, all right, boys and girls, here we go. I'm taking the Chromebooks out today. We're going to explore and design and create. And you know what happens? Bam! The Wi-Fi goes down at that moment. How do you handle that moment? How do you handle that moment? You see, when we think about those moments, they're a challenge. Handle that moment as real as I can, my friends. Here's the thing. If our students look at you as this perfect person that never makes mistakes, that knows it all, that knows the Pennsylvania standards inside and out, and can recite everything from memory, proper to backward, and we never make mistakes, like as lovingly as I can, they can't relate to you. Because they have no concept of what that feels like. Principals, the moments we stand in front of a faculty, after we made a decision that we messed up, and here's the thing, we're going to do that, and that's human too. And we stand in front of our staff and we say, you know, I did make that decision and it did not work as we planned. And I'm going to own that as your principal. But you've given a lot of feedback. We've done a lot of collaboration with other places. We're going this other direction. Thank you for your feedback. Like that moment of vulnerability. The moment of vulnerability gives our teachers permission for when things go haywire in their classrooms, doesn't it? You see, failing forward matters. But here's the reality. We also sometimes just do dumb things. I mean, I'm human too. And I'm talking about myself when I say this. Imagine we had these people right here. I mean, let's take our huge couch and put it in our tiny little car. We're gonna drive. Like, what are they thinking? Or how about this one right here, by the way? Not here at Parkland, but yeah, go ahead. The door's ready. You're good to go. Like, what? What? Come on. Come on, people. Here's the thing. Failure is an opportunity for a fresh start, isn't it? Just with a more profound impact or understanding than we had the first time. Because every time we fail, it really is an opportunity. To get up and keep trying, to get up and keep trying, and to get up and keep trying for those that look to us for direction. That's called perseverance, my friends, isn't it? And isn't that what we want for all the little ones that come to us starting again on Monday? That life skill. You see, failing forward is not just a mindset, it's also about how we persevere through adversity and, let's be real, facing that every single day. If I could add two more things real quick before I start to close. We're going to talk about staying personal and authentic in the midst of adversity. We also have to control the narrative. Now, what I want to be clear, what I'm not saying is we're minimizing voices or silencing voices. I'm not saying that at all. But you know what I know? I know from experience as one of your dads that every single day in this great district, amazing things happen. Do you agree with that? Say yes. Yes. Let's try it again, Parkland. Do you agree with that? Say yes.
Yes.
So how does our community know? How does our community know? If the greatness that happens in your school over at Schnecksville or over at Springhouse here in the high school, if the greatness gets caught on the inside of our school walls, like, we can't point the finger on that. How does our community know? You see, one way I like to talk about sharing this narrative is also through our communication, the way we communicate with our families and whatnot. I'm going to use some, I don't know, misheard song lyrics to prove that point. Because if you're like me, you're driving down Route 78, wherever you're going, you're singing to the steering wheel, a song you've heard, I don't know, like hundreds of times, and if you're totally real, you're singing the words totally wrong. And so am I. I'm going to give you five of the top misheard song lyrics. Ready, Parkland? Five of the top misheard song lyrics. Here it goes, right here. Take a listen.
Real.
Thank you, Vince. I just switched your mic. I think everything's fine.
How do we share out the greatness happening in our schools every single day? How do we give parents a glimpse into what happens in our classrooms every single day? Not out of pride and ego. You see, when I think about the incredible teachers that these two have had every year here in Parkland, every single year we have had amazing teachers every step of the way. Part of the amazing is the glimpses into the classrooms that we get to see as parents. The glimpses of the awesomeness that we happen to see as parents in the classrooms just like yours. Because here's the flip side. If we never share, and we never put things out, we never really show parents what we do, we simultaneously can't turn around and be like, well, then why are they negative? They have no idea what we're doing. Well, yeah, they don't have any idea what they're doing, but we didn't share what they're doing. You have greatness happening every single day. I'm not here to say you have to be on this tour, you have to be on that tour, you have to be on this tour, you have to be on that tour. I'm not here to say those pieces, but I'm here to say those are four tools that the largest companies in the world use to share their message. Like, why is it that a child understands Disney before they can talk? Why do they point and yell at the golden arches before they can walk? It's branding. It's sharing out the stuff. Parkland, what would be the power? I know it's a utopianist question, but hear me out. What would be the power if every single employee, almost 1,000 people in the district, if every single employee once a day for 2 to 3 minutes to share out some positive somewhere about a student, about a support staff member, about a secretary, what might be that with Parkland pride when we could all pull it together? What might be the power of 1,000 positives that are happening in our schools every single day going out? You see, it might start to change some narratives, and I know I'm in one of the most respected districts in Pennsylvania. It's part of the reason we choose to live here. But my friends, greatness is happening every single day. Tell your stories, because at the end of the day, when we allow somebody else to tell our story, they often rewrite the narrative, don't they? My friends, as I start to close here, we're going to talk about being personal and authentic in the midst of such adversity in our world. This work is about relationships. You heard it from Mark. This work is about relationships. This work is about loving and caring about kids. Every other thing that we do is secondary to that. Do me a favor, pull your cell phone out one final time. You see, it was 55 minutes ago that I asked you to send a text message to somebody you loved and cared about. If that person responded to you, can you just wave your phone in the air? Look around the room. Now I know some of y'all just did this. They're working. They'll get back to you. Promise. Here's the thing. We had almost 1,000 across the district in virtual. If we all did it. It was 1,000 messages go around our country because we stopped our day for 30 seconds to build somebody else's. Who's that teaching partner of yours, that support staff partner of yours that you know we haven't even gotten really started yet and you know they're struggling? What would a couple minutes of your time, a couple minutes of I got your back, a couple minutes of support might mean to them? Who's that child or that student that you had last year in your classroom that this year, maybe you didn't always see eye to eye with that student, but in the next day or two, you could write them a note and you could send it home and say, John, I know I'm not your teacher this year, but I want to let you know I love and care about you and I would do anything I can to help you be successful. What might be the impact or the start of a healing relationship and something like that? What might be the impact about Monday and finding students from last year just to check in to see how their day is going so it shows them that you didn't just care last year when they were in your roles, but you care every year? What might be the impact of that? You see these quick interactions. As Mark shared earlier, as your new superintendent, people matter. The interactions matter every single time. Because the best thing we can give kids this school year is not a new curriculum, not a new piece of technology, and I love that stuff. It's important stuff. I really believe it's an empathetic heart that sees and that hears theirs. My friends, I want to remind you as I close of the impact that you have. I can say that as one of your dads. The impact that you have each and every day, because I know in the midst of adversity, I know in the midst of chaos in the world, it's so easy to lose sight of, isn't it? I know what it's like being a teacher driving home with tears in my eyes because an observation didn't go the way that I had hoped. I know what it's like being a principal who made a bad call and it didn't work out and my staff was upset. And I know that feeling of letting my team down. But when I remind you and pause to remind you of the impact that you get to have every single day, I want to quickly introduce you as I start to close to a good friend of mine, a guy named Andy Johnson. I know some of you at secondary have seen some other clips from him. He wrote the foreword to my book, Personal and Authentic. But I want to take a moment, he's going to talk about impact. Because to me, the story he's about to tell is what the greatest educators do literally every single day to to encourage others. Take a moment, if you would, to listen to Ethan.
I want to share a story with you all about two gentlemen that crushed it in business. They're very well financially, crushed it. They got toward the latter years of their life, they became terminally ill, they put them in a facility to die. So they're in this facility every single day, they have a little time to where they can come out, play games, eat food, drink some water, just have a big time. And two of the gentlemen, they hit it off, like they became big buddies. So they asked the nurse, they said, nurse, can you put me and my guy in the same room? Like, we hit it off, that's my guy. She said, sure. And so she put him in the same room, and so every single day, one guy's bed was to my left, your right, one guy's bed was to my right, your left. And so every single day, nurse would bring him food, bring him something to drink, they would eat, they would drink, and the guy to my left, your right, his bed was by a window. And so his buddy on the opposite side would always say, hey man, tell me what you see out that window. His buddy would look up and he'd say, man, you know, I see a beautiful skyline. Man, I see beautiful children running, playing, beautiful married couples walking, holding hands, beautiful flowers. But you say, man, thank you so much. Really helped me before we about to die. One day, nurse came in, got off the bed by the window, was about gone. Ended up passing away and died. She prepped him, she took him out of the room, and she's taking him out, went to the opposite side, said, hey, nurse, can you do me one favor? She said, yes, what is it? Whenever you put my guy where you got to put him, will you please come back and move my bed by that window? I want the opportunity to look out that window and see what my guy is telling me about and really help with my situation. He said, sure. She came back 2 days later. She moved his bed by the window, bought him something to eat, something to drink. He got the strength to lift himself up. He looked out of that same window, and the only thing he saw was a big brick wall. Started yelling, screaming, nurse, nurse, can you come in? Nurse came in, what is it? You say, you remember my God, right? She said, of course. Say, she's telling about all these beautiful things. Like, can we please get this big brick wall for me? That really helped me in my situation. She looked at it, and she said, you didn't know, huh? I said, no, ma'am, no what? She said, you really didn't know. I said, no, ma'am, no what? She said, he was blind. She said, he couldn't have seen that even if he wanted to. She said, you didn't know every day he did it because he knew it brought you joy. She said, every day he did it because he knew it brought you happiness. Every day he did it because he knew it helped you with your situation. He's about to die himself. But you had a blind guy and looked out the window and painted a picture that he couldn't even see because he knew it served as a blessing to someone else. And so as I leave you today, I have to pose the question, why do we really do what we do and where is it taking us? Like, what's the GPS destination on the end of our decisions and our choices every single day? Like, what is it really about? Because I think we all know when the rubber meets the road, when it's all said and done, it's not about who got the best car. It's not about who got the biggest house. It's not about who stays in this neighborhood. It's not about who I know, who you. It's not about any of that. When the rubber meets the road, it's about two things. It's about who we become, and it's about what we get. And I don't know about you, but when my time comes, I don't want to be forgotten. I want to be remembered.
Those last words. I want to be forgotten. I want to be remembered. And every single teacher that I have ever met, in any of the work that I've ever done, working side by side, speaking to, I know that they also want to be remembered. What I also know is every one of you are here today because someone in some point in time in your life, maybe it was a couple years ago, maybe it was 60 years ago, there was a teacher that encouraged you, that helped push you, helped set boundaries for you, helped you to become as great as you are today. Every single in this room, person in this room has that story, has that teacher, and we're going to honor them in just a moment and who that was for you. So I'm going to ask you on the count of three, I want you to show pride and admiration for the teacher that helped you along the way by honoring them, by calling out their name. On the count of three, nice and loud to honor them. Who was it for you? 1, 2, 3. I have no idea what you all just said. Let me ask you this. If I came back 20 years from now to speak to the Parkland staff, and some of the amazing students that walked down your hallway on Monday are now on the Parkland staff. See that little girl right there? She wants to teach second grade in Parkland years from now. You see, here's the thing. If I take 20 years from now, students that you have on Monday and will learn with and grow with and support and love all year long, and if they're teaching partners of yours 20 years from now, and I ask the exact same question, would it be your name that they call it? Is it got that opportunity starting again on Monday. I will end by sharing part of my story and why I do what I do. See, I was 21 years old, fresh out of college, fresh out of Newburgh College, right down the street. Thought I had a clue is what I was getting myself into teaching fourth grade. New teachers, you'll understand what I'm talking about next week. You see, this guy right here was my mentor, Mark Weaver. You see, Mark was a 26-year veteran in the Quakertown School District. Mark was the exact kind of teacher that every single kid wanted. You know how I know? True story. Because on my very first day of teaching, I swear, every child walked into my classroom, looked across the hall, and was like, I really wish I had Mr. Weaver this year. He kept walking in. That was my first day. You see, Mark was the kind of teacher that built the energy up. As a teacher in our elementary school, he was the lifeline to our building. You see, he brought the heart, the energy, and the soul as a teacher in our building. When he walked into the faculty room, he built the energy up. He had the same expectations that I had every single day. You see, at the assemblies and those kinds of things, he built the energy up. You see, that picture right there, I treasure. That's a picture from my very first day teaching at 21 years old. And if you're wondering, yes, that's me on the right, right? See, right after that picture was taken, Mark put his arm around me and he said this. He said, Tom, the kids that are about to walk down this hallway, they need you. Tom, this work is about loving and caring about kids. Everything else we do is secondary to that. See, that's where I got that from. He said, Tom, the kids that are about to walk down this hallway, they don't know the homes that they're coming from, experiences that they're coming from, but you get to impact them. And Tom, here's the thing. As your mentor, I'll give you two options. Because the work is about loving and caring about kids. And here's the thing, if you forget that, Tom, here's two options. One, just get out and go do something different. We'll get somebody else in here that can focus on loving and caring about kids. But here's your second option. Refocus on it. Refocus on it, because this work is too important. These kids that are about to walk down this hall, they need you. And as time went on, I would watch Mark build the energy up. I watched Mark do the fun things. I watched Mark go to a faculty room, faculty meeting, and say to our principal, hey, can I take the first 2 minutes to do something fun? We're tired. We've had a long day. And take that leadership. Take that step. Take that initiative. But I would be totally real and as vulnerable as I can be in front of my kids' own teachers. I was completely struggling my first year. The amount of days that I went home to her, tears in my eyes, saying, like, I don't know if I can do this. I hear my colleagues talk about, like, next month in our curriculum. I'm like, next month? I'm trying to get to lunch today. Next month. I had this one particular student I couldn't get through. And it was October of that year, as real and vulnerable as I could be, where I totally lost it. Walked down to the faculty room, it was that kind of thing. And I hit my hand up there. They said, this kid's not getting it, he doesn't understand, I'm so tired of his nonsense, he's so disrespectful, I can't take it anymore, I called home 4 days in a row, mom never called me back, I am completely done with his nonsense. I hit my hand back on that. Loved me enough that he left his lunch on the table. He walked back down. I didn't know it at the time, to room 304 of my classroom in Idaho Elementary School. He walked across my classroom. I was in there, I had tears in my eyes, I just lost it in front of all my colleagues. He walked across the room and he pointed at me and he said, Tom, don't you ever, ever, ever do that again. He said, Tom, you want to get through to this kid, you gotta love this kid, you gotta care about this kid. You've got to do whatever it takes so this child feels loved and cared for, and then maybe he'll start to connect. Tom, you said you called home 4 times in a row, 4 days in a row. Tom, have you ever called home for something positive? What if you called home for something positive and said, hey, here's the deal. You need to call me back. Coolest thing happened today. I'm so proud of him. Maybe mom might actually call you back. Tom, maybe it's you that needs the mindset adjustment. I'm so glad that I had a mentor that loved me enough. You see, he didn't gossip about me in the faculty room. He didn't go to the principal and be like, who's this underqualified buffoon that you hired? He coached me up, man to man. He built me up and encouraged me. You see, Mark was that exact kind of teacher that people wanted to be around, that built that energy up. He was so involved in his church not too far from here. He started Da Shacks Fest for those of you that have gone. He was so involved in his community. You see, there I was finally, a few months later, finally starting to feel like I can do this. Finally starting to feel, the more that I got to connect with my kids, the less I was turning around and pointing at rules. The more I started to understand them, the better that I could actually teach them. I can do this. It was just before the spring break. It was that Wednesday. We had a half day, that long weekend, you know what I'm talking about. Mark and I stood in the hallway of Maggie Elementary School, and the night before he purchased his brand new RV, 14 footer. And he showed me all these pictures. Tom, we picked it up. Rand and I picked it up last night. Check this out. You see, here it is. Look it over here. Check this out. The bed's back here. The grill's over here. Tom, check this out over here. And I'm like, Mark, this is awesome, man. So excited. He said, yeah, tonight we're going to watch Mark Jr. play tennis at Western Maryland tomorrow. I'm so excited. We're leaving right after school here. I said, Mark, that's awesome, man. I gave him a big high five. He walked out the door. I said, hey, man, I'll see you on Tuesday. Next day, I got up. I walked down to the mailbox. I pulled out the newspaper. And that was the trumpet. See, my mentor. His brand new RV rolled down the Pennsylvania Turnpike, and he and Ray lost their life. The impact of a teacher, the impact of the work people like you get to do every single day. You see, as the stories came out, and the stories came out, they talked about his leadership, they talked about his relationships, they talked about the people side of the work. Never one time did they mention what he taught. It was all about who he was, the relationships he had with people. You see, my friends, the stories and the stories of the people and the people, thousands of people paid respects at a church not too far from here. Thousands of people. Don't you ever, ever, ever say that you're just a teacher, just a secretary, just a custodian, just a support staff member, because you have just the right opportunity every single day to impact the lives of our amazing kids and our amazing community in Parkland. It's exactly what you do, because I see it every single day. You see, your legacy is not going to be determined by the content you taught. And the content you taught, of course, it's important. It's going to be determined by how well we serve, the relationships we build, the people matter, as our superintendent said earlier, side of things. As Daddy, I beg you, this year, teach hard. Give them your all, but as one of your dads, love them harder. It's really what they need, that connection, that relationship, that people side of things. You see, it's your fingerprints of impact, my friends, that really do radiate throughout our incredible community. My very first words in Personal and Authentic, you see on the screen, the work is hard. What you do is hard. I wrote that just before the pandemic, and if I could rewrite it after the pandemic, I would say the work is ridiculously hard. But you know what I know? I know the kids that you serve. I know the families that you serve, my neighbors. I know they absolutely work. My friends, that's my family, that's my babies. And I know some of you know them. They get to sit right there today. Some of you don't. The reason I share that is because they're my whole world. They're why I do what I do. You see, and on Monday, when every single student walks back from your great room, every single child is somebody else's entirely. Do we teach like that? Do we lead like that? My friends, do we love them like that? Parkland, your story is not finished yet. Go get it. Thanks for your time.
I've seen Tom Murray speak multiple times at keynotes and at different buildings, and I can say, coming off of the year that we've had, that was exactly what everybody needed. So thank you very much for helping us to reconnect. This is just a little something from the foundation, and we have some more stuff for you too. So thank you for being a part of this. Thanks. So. Thank you. The next two individuals are also invested in the Parkland community and care about kids and all of you. I am pleased to recognize the leadership of our professional and support staff labor organizations who will share the opening day message with you. Please join me in welcoming Mrs. Sandy Gockenbach, our Parkland Education Association president, and Mrs. Elizabeth Moyer, president of the support personnel in the Parkland School District.
After a year of being online, it's so funny to make sure I wasn't
crying. Oh my God.
That was a really hard presentation to follow up. My pleasure to welcome you back to a new school year in person at Parkland and extend a warm welcome to Dr. Madsen. When thinking about today, I truly struggled with what to say to all of you this morning. Isn't that the pervasive feeling lately? How to survive the struggle? And that struggle looks different for each and every one of us in a time where we just need a little bit of normal and peace in our lives. My most recent struggle is the aversion to pandemic vocabulary. I would love to never again hear the words new normal, unprecedented, pivot, and Zoom bomb. However, I have been able to successfully rally around the word quarantine. During my struggles, though, I have been acutely reminded that all that really matters is that the people you love are happy and healthy. We have the important job of making sure those same feelings extend to our students as well. Their struggle should be at the forefront of our minds. In the adult world, not everyone will be happy with the decisions we make and what this year may potentially bring. After all, you can't please everyone. You're not an avocado. Stay the course, do what you know is best for the kids in front of you. They will take their cues from the adults around them and learn how to react in the face of adversity. As colleagues, we need to lift each other up on the days that may be difficult and not drag each other down. Being optimistic about the future won't change the situations we currently have to work through, but it can change the mood and the tone of your days. We are all learning how critical it is to care for our mental health. So at home, at the end of your school day, it may help to remind the people that you live with, if you love someone, let them sleep. Because the job is exhausting and our students need us rested and ready now more than ever. Help each other on this journey and have a wonderful school year. Thank you.
Students and staff with every aspect of our new learning platforms. secretaries, hall monitors, playground aides, grounds crew, maintenance department, all found themselves doing something entirely different than ever before. Our cafeteria staff has worked harder than ever before as well, preparing meals and transporting them to whatever location was needed for the students. We have all done more and worked together to do the best we could for each of the students that we were here to serve. 21-22 school year is here, and we are ready. Our schools look great, our buses are fueled, we are embarking on another school year. Changes will keep coming, and we prove that we can adapt and succeed. I wish you all the very best for an incredible year this year. Thank you very much.
In closing, we recognize that there's a lot of work that has to get done this year, but keep remembering that everything that you do, all of us, we do it for the kids, and together we will be stronger. Think about our Parkland family tree. We have strong roots, and we're guided by principles and passion. The Parkland School District is one of the premier school districts in the state of Pennsylvania because of you. As you begin this school year, tell your story, as Tom said, and share your Parkland pride. We support you. We thank you. Now let's get this year started. Go have some fun. That concludes our program, everyone. Thank you for everyone who was involved today. And if you want, remember your pledge card up front. Really appreciate it. On behalf of our administrative team, have an incredible year. Thank you all.